I will start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land where we are, the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung, and pay my respects to their elders and acknowledge that we are on Wurundjeri land that has not been ceded, and pay respect to all Aboriginal people, and particularly through the current period we're in, where I think Aboriginal people are having to show incredible grace and forbearance through this debate and discussion, which we're going to have tonight. Janet has asked me very briefly to say something about Labor Academy, and she's told me that it's a wonderful thing. And it is going to be a wonderful thing, and it is really a cooperative within the Labor Party about raising our knowledge, our understanding, and doing that for the better of the Labor and the Labor movement, but also for the better of Australia as well. And I can think of no better learning experience than we're about to have tonight. So if I hand over to you and Professor Langton, and I look forward to a very interesting and educational evening. Thank you.
Well, thanks so much. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'd like to start by acknowledging my acknowledgement of meeting on the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, acknowledge elders past and present, acknowledge that sovereignty was never ceded, and the importance of the conversation that we're about to have tonight for a deeper understanding of justice. My name's Jennifer Balint. I do work in law and society, and I am head of School of Social and Political Sciences. I'm going to do some introductions. I know the people here probably don't need an introduction, but it's really important that we do a proper introduction. And so firstly like to, I have here on my right, Professor Marcia Langton. Professor Marcia Langton AO is an anthropologist and geographer, and since 2000 has held the Foundation Chair of Australian Indigenous Studies at the University of Melbourne. She's produced a large body of knowledge in the areas of political and legal anthropology, Indigenous agreements and engagement with the minerals industry, and Indigenous culture and art. Her 2012 Boyer Lectures series titled The Quiet Revolution, Indigenous People and the Resources Boom is a key contribution. And in 1993, Marcia Langton was made a member of the Order of Australia in recognition of her work in anthropology and advocacy of Aboriginal rights. Professor Langton is a fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia, and she was honoured as a University of Melbourne Redmond Barry Distinguished Professor. We have Professor Aaron Korn here with us tonight as well, who's the inaugural director of the Indigenous Knowledge Institute. With 3 decades' experience of close collaboration with Indigenous colleagues, he's worked towards broader recognition for the significance of Indigenous knowledge through multiple research and education initiatives, and his previous work as a lecturer in Australian Indigenous Studies and completion of a PhD at the University of Melbourne involved extensive collaboration with Indigenous colleagues in Arnhem Land. He's been director of the National Centre for Aboriginal Language and Music Studies and the Centre for Aboriginal Studies and Music at the University of Adelaide. And he's served as a director of the National Recording Project for Indigenous Performance in Australia since 2010, and has previously served on the Australian Research Council College of Experts. So welcome to this really important dialogue between Indigenous labour, Indigenous law and labour. And I wanted to start by asking you both, why was this book, Law, The Way of the Ancestors, important to write?
Well, I'll start. So thank you, Jennifer, and thanks for the very warm welcome. We were asked by the publisher of Thames and Hudson, the publisher of this series, First Knowledges, of which I think ours is the 6th book, yes, to write about Indigenous leadership, because that's a hot topic. And we conferred, so the way this series works, I should step back a little, the way this series works is that each edition is co-authored by an Indigenous person and a non-Indigenous person, both of whom should be experts in the area. So when I was asked to be a contributor to the series. I immediately went to Aaron because we've collaborated for so long on matters of, you know, the survival of Indigenous traditions, say mostly in music and performance, but they themselves are governed by law. So we talked about this problem of Indigenous leadership, and we thought that was a very narrow way to enter the main problem, and that is, you know, the entire body of Aboriginal laws, which are often called by the courts, you know, traditions and customs, so that people understand what is expected of an Aboriginal person or a Torres Strait Islander person, and what is expected of their leaders. And so we went back to the publishers and said, we want to write about law. They readily accepted the proposition. And as Henry Reynolds says, I know this is rather bad taste to read from your book blurb, but he's right. And I didn't realise until I saw his blurb come in that he's absolutely right. No other current work has been able to so comprehensively explain the significance of traditional law in all its manifestations. So it's quite true. It's not since 1982, when the Australian Law Reform Commission was asked to inquire into the recognition of Aboriginal customary laws, that there has been a comprehensive overview of Aboriginal laws. So most people won't even remember the very good report by the Commissioner. And the Australian Law Reform Commission made some recommendations. And one was that, you know, from memory, to the greatest extent possible and where relevant, Aboriginal laws should be recognised so long as they are not repugnant in relation to Australian law. So there are a lot of myths about Aboriginal law. Some people think that it's all about, you know, punishing people with spears. That's punishment, that's not law. It's proper. So the big outcome, actually, and it's only been very recently that this has happened, so it's taken, goodness me, 40 years. The big recommendation from that report was the recognition of Torres Strait Islander adoption laws, customary adoption laws. So now, finally, this year, they are recognised, and children who are allocated, orphaned or, you know, for some reason unable to live with their biological parents, are allocated by family and elders to other families. And these are very proper adoptions in Torres Strait Islander society. And in fact, Koiki Mabo was actually adopted in that way. And there was some dispute in the Supreme Court of Queensland about him, you know, his situation. But even in the Mabo case, his adoption was regarded by the judges as legitimate. So that was an outcome. There are many other instances where that report has had an influence, but most people have forgotten it. They recommended, for instance, or at least one of the outcomes was that there should be recognition of second, third and fourth wives in relation to receipt of the widow's pension. Huge hullabaloo about it that most people have forgotten. And, you know, I think it's quite sort of randomly and nastily applied by Social Security bureaucrats. But every, you know, widow, Aboriginal widow, who's a second, third or fourth wife should receive, you know, the widow's pension. And the same goes for single parents, pension, and there's need for other reforms. But in relation to customary law, they're two sort of ordinary instances that would make life much better for Aboriginal people. Mm. So one of the things I said when I first came to this university, I gave my inaugural professorial lecture, which I recycled as the Alfred Deakin lecture, on the, you know, centenary of Federation. I said, well, the High Court has recognised our land laws in Mabo number 2, but they haven't recognised the entire body of Aboriginal laws. Why not? So it has remained a problem for a very, very long time. And so it gave us the opportunity then to explain in very straightforward terms how Aboriginal laws work, because people have forgotten and they don't know. Mm-hmm. It's more and more the case that an Australian in professional life, be a lawyer or a social worker, or anybody working in an Aboriginal community, is going to run smack bang into Aboriginal laws in action. Mm. So there's not much out there. Teachers are not trained. You know, they're told, go and teach in paradise. You'll love it. Mm. And they get there and they leave within 2 years because they're simply not trained to work in a completely different culture with completely different laws and completely different languages and kinship systems. Mm. So we thought, well, let's write the primer. Mm. Yeah.
It's worth saying those adoption laws exist everywhere on the continent too.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Mm. I should have said that.
Mm. I mean, you know, they are everywhere. Mm. I think what their recognition in the Torres Strait is sort of an artifact of Mabo too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. And that was really, it's what's so compelling, what I found so compelling in your book is how you really make so visible that living law, that law in action. This is not past, it's absolutely present, it's future. It's a really different approach to how Western law thinks about itself, how law is generally talked about. You note in the book that the way of the ancestors is not just a body of rules or a digest of what is and is not permitted. While those are necessary parts of any legal system, law is so much more. It's the great desire for harmony and balance, the proper comportment of a person in the world made by prolific ancestors long ago, the regard for all places and species as sacred, and the inner meanings of all known things. It is all this and much more. You write elsewhere that keeping law is so much more than following rules. Can you talk a little bit more about that, this totality of law that you bring to life so beautifully and so clearly, in the book?
I thought your example from Wanta is a very good way of explaining that. Perhaps
the epitaph.
Mm. The mosaic in front of Parliament House.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Okay, so one of our key interlocutors, colleagues, is one of our professorial fellows in the Indigenous Knowledge Institute at the University of Melbourne. He's, I suspect, the first Warpri person in history to ever carry the title of professor. That's a program that we created precisely for people with the kind of knowledge that he has. Mm. And we used to teach together at the Australian National University about a decade ago in Canberra, and part of the way that we taught was to go on the walk up to and around Parliament House. Mm. And we would always invariably stop on the forecourt design first. Mm. And he would ask students to interrogate what that was about. So that's how I learned about this. It's a Walbury design, not by Wanta, but by another, very famous Walbury artist, now deceased.
Kumanjai Nelson Jacamara.
Yeah.
So I'll just describe it briefly. If you
It's in the front cover of the book.
Yes, we have an image of it in the front cover of the book. But
it's that one.
Yes. Yeah. But in situ, in front of Parliament House, it's a massive circular mosaic made with small round pieces of sandstone, coloured sandstone, naturally coloured sandstone, in this design.
It's based on a sand painting. It's a It's a rendition of a traditional sand painting rendered permanent. And it's...
And there's a water body around it, right?
Yeah, there's a water
body. Like a moat around it. Yeah. So if you've been to Parliament House and waited at the security gate to go in, if you look right, you look towards the war memorial, and it's in the forecourt, and it's a huge mosaic. It's this sacred design in our book.
Yeah. We guesstimated in a normal year about 800,000 visitors would stand on it every year as they enter Parliament House or come out of it. And it's not a randomly selected design. There was a process with about six artists, I think, to work out what the design was. But the design that was chosen was the one that actually reflected a Walpree version of what a parliamentary representative proportional democracy would look like. And it's a representation, one of many, of the Jardi Wanpa ceremony. It's the first Walpree ceremony used to start the annual cycle of ceremonies that traditionally happens. And it is the, how do we put it? It's the fire purification ceremony that is the process through which everybody lays all disagreements and enmities, you know, that have arisen throughout the year to bed, so that the ceremonial season, which always starts when the pointers touch the horizon, which is around about October there.
The pointers of the Southern Cross.
The pointers of the Southern Cross, yeah. So the whole ceremonial sequence can actually be conducted with decorum, peace, harmony, goodwill, so on and so forth. So it's about calling people to order and actually saying, well, look, whatever disagreements and grievances you might have, well, you can't exercise them here because this is a proper legal context now with real ramifications for people and their lives. And, you know, a lot of people would look at it and see it as a piece of art, piece of public art. It's not that. It's actually a very deliberate Walpree reflection of the business that's meant to take place in Parliament inside the building.
But it's, and you've described the elements of it and the very orderly fashion in and design features that depict the skin names, the totems, and their relationships. So that's all depicted in the mosaic design.
To cut a long story short, in Walpree societies and, you know, ones that border them, there are four ceremonial groups. They all have shared power in the system. It's not a class hierarchy where one is dominant over another. All four groups, which own patchwork estates, that are all interspersed with each other's, everybody else's estates. All those four groups have the same rights and influence under Walpree law, and no Walpree law can take place without those four groups having, you know, equal participation and equal, you know, sort of, I guess, you know, rights to determining outcomes. It's interesting that when Wanta and I used to teach students, you know, the thing he'd point out when looking at, it's basically animal footprints, 12 coming from different directions, the cardinal directions, and it's wallabies and possums. And they're all, the footprints of them are all walking towards a great fire, which is the ceremony in the centre. And he'd always say, well, how do you think the animals are walking? You know, because you can read from the tracks how they're actually moving. And it's really very interesting because, of course, they're all walking in supplication. So the wallabies are on all fours. They're all bowing as they walk towards the fire, which is, you know, this great icon of law to which everybody must bow so that everybody is equal under the law.
And you do literally bow at fire ceremonies.
Absolutely.
So you have to bow down quite low in front of the elders, and they almost hit you with big fire sticks, and you're covered with sparks. And then you have to walk up through an avenue of fire sticks, enormous fire sticks, like a fire sticks on each side of the avenue.
Yeah. You filmed one of these, didn't you?
I wrote the script for one of the films made by Rachel Perkins many years ago, Jardy Wunpa.
Jardy Wunpa, interestingly, in the Warbri language, translates as deep sleep. Because, again, it's putting enmities to rest. It's putting to bed things that would otherwise, you know, confound the processes. So, you know, I think if you look at, you know, parliamentary democracies around the world and question time, you know, there's probably a different ethos working there.
Because what you're describing is a great balance, a great reciprocity, a great sense of deep respect.
Balance is always... Mm. I mean, Marcia and I have talked about this a lot, even before writing the book. I mean, balance are always ideals, you know. I mean, the Walpuri understanding that relates to this image and other images like it is informed effectively by the template of the Southern Cross. The whole kinship system, the whole, you know, legal system is informed by the template of the Southern Cross, these sort of four points moving around a central axis. And the Southern Cross looks the way it does in the night sky because the world is not perfect. Because the middle star is off centre as a reminder to us that if we don't work to create that harmony, then, you know, entropy will take over and there will be disharmony. So, you know, there's a very realistic understanding in these societies that don't, I think, you know, try to, you know, idolise too much, you know, the capacities of humans. But these things are actually ideals to which people are expected to aspire. And if you want to have leadership in these systems, if you want to, you know, become very senior leaders in these systems, you actually have to be somebody who can outwardly embody those ideals.
And that comes through really strongly in the book. The outward embodying, that it's the modelling, the practice of law is both private and public. But it's there at every stage. It's not static. It is embodied, modelled, sought. So those ideals are actually very much embedded in everyday life and everyday practice.
The word Marcia chose for the quote you read, it's comportment. You know, what is the proper conduct of a senior person? Wanda was actually at Marcia's house when he read through the whole manuscript to make sure that we got it right and, you know, we'd cited his sources properly and, you know, we hadn't overstepped what we could and couldn't say about Walpuri law, and he read the whole thing. And very, very top-ranking leaders who've successfully completed the entire Walpuri ceremonial process, the term for that is your Walpuri. And it means people keeper. I actually said, oh, so they're like peacekeepers then. He said, oh, close. It actually technically means people keeper.
It's really interesting, the peacekeeper, the people keeper.
Not many people make it to become your Walpuri. Like, it's not something that it's accepted everybody can achieve. It takes a particular kind of person to be able to achieve that.
So, in the book you talk about the way of the ancestors is not in the past. It's not static. What do we need to take from this?
Well, see, the ancestors are ever-present. And earlier in Australia's history, observers of Aboriginal life thought that Aboriginal people didn't have a religion, that they had superstitions, animism, you know, not a real religion. But there was a wonderful anthropologist, W.E.H. Stanner, Bill Stanner, and I knew him when I was an undergraduate student at the ANU. And I pay my respects to him in this book because he invented the word everywhen. So what he tried to do was grapple with the big Aboriginal concepts, which were sort of poorly translated by people like Strello, Baldwin Spencer, and those characters, you know, the very early anthropologists. And Bill Stanner himself was an Anglican, had, you know, worked in the imperial reaches. He'd worked in Africa, he'd worked in Australia. I think he'd been an officer in one of the defence forces, I can't remember which one. And he was in that cohort of, you know, Nugget Coombs, Charles Rowley and so on, who after the Second World War set up all kinds of institutions in Australia that we take for granted now, like the Australia Council, Opera Australia. Nugget was 8 times the governor of the Reserve Bank. I won't go on about it, but anyway, Stanner was very much the intellectual, with a deep, deep interest in Aboriginal life, and he'd been working at Daly River in the Northern Territory. And he came across a man, and I asked for his photo to be put in the book, Nungia Mary, and his biographical account of Nungia Mary is a very beautiful, acute observation of the life of a man living at that time when the frontier was, you know, coming to an end, and the worst impacts of the frontier could be seen, and Stanner didn't retreat from any of that. But he was chasing the great mystery of Aboriginal religion. He recognised that it was a religion, and he went walking up into the sacred areas in the escarpments with a group of Aboriginal men, and he began to understand their religion, and he called the concept that others had called dreaming the everywhen. And so, therefore, the great dramatic sacred past when ancestral beings had made the world was still with us. And he tried to capture how the leaders of the Aboriginal religion, you know, who might get drunk one day, and, you know, he actually met Nungia Mary on the edge of a great battle, the Makarrata, and that's where the best description of a Makarrata is. But then followed them on their religious travels, their, you know, which you might say in English was a pilgrimage. Mm. They went to sacred places, and he wrote an incredible monograph called On Aboriginal Religion. So he had a great many beautiful things to say. On the other hand, all of the churches did not regard what Aboriginal people believed in as a religion, and they simply said that Aboriginal people had no religion. And to this day, you won't hear people talking about Aboriginal religion. They'll talk about spirituality, which still has that connotation of superstition. But it is a, you know, people have called it a sort of poetic interpretation of the world, but it's so much more than that as well, because it combines a deep understanding of the environment, the way that the sky works, you know, how the celestial heavens behave and what's up there in great detail, and the seasons, animal and plant behaviour, climate, weather. So the possums and the wallabies are not just metaphors. They're the consubstantiation of human life, the present world, and the great sacred past. So, you know, the word totem was brought by the English, and it actually comes from North America, where an Indian agent working with the Mohawk discovered that they had dodem, or totems. And so it was through the literature of the Indian agent, and indeed Marx and Stalin that the term went into the English language, and so the anthropologist transported it here. Mm. It's not a very good rendition of the systems that we're describing, but I guess the main point is that there are religions. Mm. I ran into a priest once back in the 80s, and he was allowing Aboriginal ceremonies to occur on a mission. I was there to teach people how to vote. And I said, this is unusual. You're the first priest I've ever seen allow ceremonies to occur. Mm. He said, I've written to the Vatican, and I told the Vatican that they have a philosophy. And being satisfied with that, I am allowed to let them have their ceremonies. Mm. But if it had been a religion, he wouldn't have been able to do that. So, you know, they were competing for souls and they didn't want another religion in the way. Mm. And so, you know, people like that old priest got around the problem by telling their colleagues that it was a philosophy. Mm. And it is indeed in many ways a philosophy. Mm. So, yeah, there's a lot to be said about the long history of people observing Aboriginal religions. And so we wanted to kind of, while, you know, nodding to the best of them, like Stanner, move away from that, you know, anthropologies, if you like, and that anthropological history, and describe it in its own terms in the way that we had to learn it. I mean, we had to learn it at the feet of masters, right? And at first you have no idea what's going on, like Stanner at the, you know, the Makarata with Nangia Mary. You know, what's going on here? No clue. And so slowly, slowly, slowly you learn by being there. And so this is what we've tried to capture so that if anybody sees what we saw, they'll say, okay, so that's Aboriginal law in real life.
There are also societies in which the religion law split is not particularly pronounced. I mean, they're much more like Dharmic religions. Mm. You know, you could almost reduce translations in different languages here of what is happening spiritually to something as simple as the way in English. you know, it's actually way better than dreaming. You could actually just call it the way. Even the way people talk about ancestors, they're all about, you know, like the Yolngu term, lukumopan, to chase the foundation. You know, like they're all about following in the footsteps of the people who have gone before. The, you know, thousands of nameless, faceless people who we are all descended from, who we will never know. Because, you know, over time, you know, memory of those individuals fades when you go back 20 generations. You know, and also, you know, when it comes to natural cycles and the behaviours of species, there's an understanding that, you know, different species also have their own ways, right? You know, they have their own nature, they have their own breeding cycles, they have their own patterns. And humans are reliant on understanding those patterns because if you, you know, I guess don't know how a beehive works, you're not going to be able to harvest honey or actually keep honey supply going. So it's often things like that that are actually the most sacred of all. You know, not over exploiting resources is one of the really, really big ones.
And what comes through, sorry, Marcia.
Well, can I just read one thing from this chapter, Wisdom and Leadership, which Aaron wrote, instructed by Wanta, chapter 7. Associating the digging stick pointers as they touch the horizon with the name Kananganja, I am going to eat and drink, caste ceremonies as a direct conduit for accessing the law of the Southern Cross. When buried as a great yala beneath the earth's curvature in the hot season, that's the yam, the Southern Cross represents the nourishing feast of ancestral knowledge to be had through ceremonial participation. the association of the two Magellanic clouds as goanna holes with the name Yankari, people coming and going, however, acknowledges that ceremonial participation inevitably becomes increasingly difficult as you advance through the grades and are required to develop greater resilience and command over your emotions and actions. There is therefore no expectation that all people will necessarily complete all grades or even be capable of doing so without sometimes taking long breaks in between. The entry and exit holes of the goanna nest therefore represent the free choice of individuals to progress through ceremonial grades at their own pace and only as far as they want. Advancement through the ceremonial grades can also be withheld from people who have breached the law. To gain re-entry, males, for example, must discover for themselves how to pluck a breast feather from the deadly wedge-tailed eagle for a presentation to his ceremonial leaders. So, you know, there are grades and there are tests and there's knowledge to be learnt, and it is extremely difficult. And women have not the same thing at all, but very much, you know, the ceremonial cycle. There are women of high degree and almost nothing in the literature refers to them. And so, and it's also a very secret part of Aboriginal religion. And so in my chapter on Aboriginal women's law, I've described what it achieves, but I haven't been able to provide a great deal of detail because women's law is extremely secretive.
What I do like about what you wrote about that, it struck me the first time I read it to do the edit, was that I had never thought about it this way. It makes perfect sense when you hear it out loud, but so much of what leaders do and what ceremonies test people in is the negotiation of their own emotional interiority. Because, of course, we know that emotions can be highly destructive and, of course, they can be highly beneficial. But, you know, if you are being challenged by quite, you know, challenging and destructive emotions, that can create immense disharmony. And part of the job of older people is to mediate that for people who are less experienced at it, to say, well, you're not the only person who's been here before, and you know, you need to think about it this way, and to actually just try and temper people and, you know, talk them back from the ledge. I mean, that for me was a real eye-opener reading that, because of course, you know, I've seen that, and you know, I've seen that in practice. I've never understood it that way though.
And that's very much the role of very senior women. It's sometimes captured in the grand healing practices. There are actual healers, and they're called different things around the country, but I think the Nunkery of Central Australia have become quite famous. They have won awards from, say, the Royal College of Psychiatrists for their work in this regard, of teaching people how to not just manage their emotions, but grow emotionally. So just this is a very practical example. I'm not sure that I described it in the book. I think I wanted to. But anyway, they know that young people, especially young men, are not capable of speaking about their emotions. And they know that people who have become alienated from society or depressed in some way are not capable of speaking about their emotions. So they enable people to speak about their emotions, especially people who haven't learnt their language properly and haven't learnt English properly or are, you know, poorly socialised. They published a set of about 50 fridge magnets, one with each one with a word on it that expresses an emotion or a state of being with the English translation, and they all fit very nicely into what looks like an old tobacco tin, and you can take them out and put them on the fridge. They also have posters and so on, and so there's 50 words for emotions and states of being, and they teach everybody to learn the words so that they have the words for talking about their emotions. And so instead of saying, I feel sick, or I don't want to talk to you, I don't want to talk to anybody, they can say, I feel sad. And they've got the proper Pijindjara word for saying that I feel sad, or whatever the emotion is. And, you know, they range from the negative emotions through to the highly positive emotions. And that enables people not just to talk about their emotional states of being, but by talking to others, and they encourage people to talk together, they're able to grow together to realise that you don't have to be stuck in that one emotional state. There is an alternative state, and it's being happy about being with your brothers and sisters, for instance, right? And also how to be good parents, how to be good grandparents, how to be good husbands, how to be good wives. And so they have ceremonies for all of that. They have ceremonies for bringing babies into the world. They have, you know, funeral ceremonies. But they also have ceremonies for making people love each other, and so on. Yeah.
You just reminded me, I had to explain this to somebody a few days ago, but just the whole sort of what it is to be a good person and how that builds you up spiritually and how those two things are linked to make societies, you know, better for people. You know, even things like if you were driving past in a car and you see a family struggling with their shopping to get home, then you stop the car and you put them in the car. Right. And that's just a social expectation that's linked to a quite complex concept about building the muscle of the soul. And, you know, it's the term, it relates to the term Lian in the Kimberley and Ma in your warm up there, and it has other translations in other Australian languages. But, you know, the soul is like a muscle and you can exercise it and you can build up your spiritual power through doing acts of goodness, not just descending ceremonies, but just helping people home with their shopping. And you can see how, you know, these set up social constructs that when they're, you know, functioning unmolested, make places, you know, relatively, you know, good places to live and to be. You know, anybody who's had any kind of engagement with things like the criminal justice system would know that teaching people to use their words and have command over their emotions can prevent a lot of human suffering. So these things are actually intrinsic to why societies even have laws, not how we interpret them, but why we even have them to begin with.
So it's a sense of a collective you're talking about, not just as well as the individual.
Yeah. Responsibility.
Yes, the collective and responsibility, which are very, you know, vague sociological terms in a way. But just for example, this idea of, you know, helping people and building your soul muscle.
It's a good, we just coined that.
Yeah, we just coined that.
That's how it described to me. It's like if the muscle had a soul, your Mar or your Lian would be it.
So the most powerful people in Aboriginal society traditionally, and you know, you still see this, and we've been beneficiaries of it, is the person who is kind and generous and a good person. That person attracts to them other people because they're good to be around. They're not only good for a free feed, right, and a place to sleep, they're just good to be around. They are the people then who have a number of wives, for instance, and they keep a happy, peaceful life, a productive life, so everybody goes hunting or fishing or working or bringing in money, and so they are the people with the resources to host a ceremony. People will come to the ceremony, and so this person becomes a leader, a ceremonial leader, by being generous, right? And so leaders are in fact created by generosity, reciprocity, care for others, kindness to others.
And I think there's probably a misunderstanding about, well, you know, birthright determines leadership. It actually doesn't. I mean, that's one conduit for it, as in, you know, many sort of systems, whether it be, you know, passing on your corporate inheritance to your heirs. But you actually can't be a leader without a body of people who are prepared to follow you. Mm. Like, it actually doesn't work that way. If you mistreat people and are a terrible person, you will have nobody to lead. And, you know, this actually happens a lot.
It's a fantastic model of leadership.
Yeah.
Mm. So one of the things that comes through very strongly in the book is the importance of this for today. So this is not something that we're learning about in an anthropological way. It's present. It is future think forward thinking. It's about the integrity of our society as a whole. It maintains our society. And of course, one of the things that's most present for us is the referendum we're going to have in a few weeks, and what the Australian people are going to be asked in relation to the recognition of the First Peoples of Australia and the establishment of an Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander voice. In the book, you talk about the voice as a social contract, and you tie it very clearly to law. Could you tell us a bit more about what this means, you know, the voice as social contract?
Yeah, well, I think most authentic and genuine Aboriginal leaders, not the ones who've been handpicked by political parties, but people who've come up through the Aboriginal ranks, are people who take responsibility in the Aboriginal world, responsibility for others, responsibility for themselves. And it's not a political slogan. It's actually, you know, a body of practice. Mm. Going to ceremonies, looking after others, keeping kinship relationships going, keeping groups of people bound together by kinship and law. Mm. People who do that are the genuine, authentic leaders. And they have long wanted a relationship of reciprocity with the Australian government. So, you know, imagine being a person in a remote Aboriginal community and you hear about this place, Canberra, and you see these politicians flying in and out in their planes, and then when they leave, you hear about some decision that they've made, right? It might have been, you know, the decision to mine at Yirrkala.
Yeah.
Or that's a very famous one. There's a lot of Aboriginal law around that.
Yeah.
It might have been the Barunga statement where there was a request for a treaty. It was a sacred painting painted by a Yolngu leader and a desert leader from the Aranda people. And it was presented to Bob Hawke when he was Prime Minister and his Minister for Indigenous Affairs, Gerry Hand. Bob Hawke made a commitment to a treaty and then he went away and said he couldn't do it. So, but back in the time, even before that, Aboriginal people who follow this body of Yolngu law that we describe in the book talked about a makarata, you know. They came here, they took our land, they killed our people. They need to settle this feud with us through a makarata. And that settlement is the way to deal with us. So it has to follow Aboriginal law. It has to be, people have to be on an equal basis with each other. And then the man who died recently, the great leader who died this year, Dr. Yinapingu, he has an honorary doctorate from our university, remembered those times because when he was young, he was an interpreter for the Aboriginal Land Rights Commissioner, Sir Edward Woodward, who later became the Chancellor of this university. And Sir Edward Woodward conducted the hearings in the Land Rights Inquiry and Yunupingu, as a young person, was the interpreter. So from a young age, he was interpreting matters of high law to a white judge, and that's how the Aboriginal Land Rights Act came about. And he remembered this, you know, the way that people talked about the Makarrata back then, and then he gifted the term Makarrata to the 250 delegates at the Uluru National Indigenous Constitutional Convention. And so, you know, it became the concept of the Makarrata Commission for overseeing treaty standards as they develop. But also, you know, its profound meaning of drawing feuds to a close through an ordeal. So this idea of the voice as, you know, an open and free relationship between the government of Australia and the governors of Aboriginal Australia is held very dear in people's hearts. This is their great aspiration. And, you know, they want proper representation. They want to be heard. And they don't want to be talked about. They want to be spoken with. They want to make joint decisions. They don't want other people making decisions for them and forcing them to break their own laws, forcing them to dispense with their own laws. They want a system of law in Australia that works for them, not against them. And they've made that very clear year after year for decades. So I think if I were to try to summarise what I think, you know, the kind of leaders we write about in this book want from the voice, that would be it. Did you have anything to add to that?
Probably, but you're right. I mean, yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah, I mean, yeah, none of this stuff is new, all right? The leaders have been requesting these kinds of relationships for as long as there have been relationships across cultures on this continent. You know, we might not even know how far they go back because, of course, you know, the earliest ones might not even be recorded. But
some of them are, in fact.
Yeah.
And Henry Reynolds has written about that.
Yeah.
But it was, I just want to remind you that it was Dr. Yunupingu who raised the idea of constitutional recognition as part of the Makarrata, part of the settlement of the feud. And he did that with Kevin Rudd when he was Prime Minister. And it happened on our campus at University House on Professor's Walk. So I made sure that, you know, the Melbourne Institute annual conference invited him to talk about Indigenous economic development. And his clan's very, very good at that. I mean, you might have seen the NASA rocket blasts.
Yes.
That's on the land of his clan. Mm. And there is a very formal relationship between NASA and the Gumatj clan. So anyway, long before that, he was here. He gave a presentation, and then I took him and his lawyer to University House for a cup of tea. And we walked in and ran into Kevin Rudd, and I nudged his lawyer and I said, come on, get them together. And so that is where he put it to Rudd that he had some very important matters to put to him and invited him to Arnhem Land. And I think we have that petition that he presented to Rudd in Arnhem Land in the book.
The full transcript is there.
Yes. Yes.
Which actually has the proper Yungamata spellings in it, unlike the versions that are online, which were written by people who weren't literate in Yungamata. And we've actually taken that apart analytically to... Well, let's have a look at it. Can we find it?
I'm looking for it.
I mean, in that Babaji, I'll use his nickname. In that, Babaji uses, you know, he basically explains, I mean, in Yolngu law, there are three chambers of law. There's a public chamber in which public things happen.
Got it.
Yeah. There's a, you know, completely restricted chamber, which is, I don't know, sort of like stuff that we have sealed in our system for 50 or Victoria or whatever, and then there's sort of a chamber in between that, you know, is like the interface between the two. And he's very, very precise and articulate about how laws and also the rights of citizens function under those laws. That statement from, is it 98, to Rudd, is actually one of the most... No, sorry, that's the one to Howard.
They presented them to John Howard.
Yeah.
And what's this one here?
Let me have a look. That one, oh yes, this is the one to Howard, the Elko Island and Yirrkala petitions of 1998. Yeah.
Right.
And yeah, it's an extraordinary piece of literature, that document. It actually crystallises how Yolngu law works in a very, very succinct way. It's completely clear how it works. It's just that you've got to understand a lot of non-English terms to understand it fully.
So we tell a bit of this history, and this is the one to John Howard. It's not the one to Rudd, which was the one that was set us on this path, actually, to the referendum. But just for example, letter to the Parliament of the Commonwealth of Australia on traditional Yolngu law. We, the undersigned, are Dalkara and Jirake, the political representatives and leaders of our sovereign clan nations comprising all the Yolngu within this Miwach region of northeast Arnhem Land, the northeast. We bring to you our diplomatic request from the Ngara, or traditional parliaments, of our clans and nations and estates to the Parliament of the Commonwealth of Australia. We request that you recognise the Dulma Mulkabati title deeds, which establish the legal tenure for each of our traditional clan estates. Your Westminster system calls this native title. The jurisdiction, number two, the jurisdiction of our Ngara traditional parliament in the same way as we recognise your parliament and Westminster system of government. Mm. Three, both formally and legally recognise our Marian system of law. Within our Marian, there are three different levels of government that provide for the peace, order and good government of the people's citizens. One, open or public, garma ceremonies, where all citizens may be present. Two, semi-public, duni, chambers of law, where only certain parts of the legal procedures may be conducted in public. And three, closed, restricted ngara, chambers of law, which may only be attended by those political leaders who represent the citizens. So there is very much a system of leadership and of governance and representation that is inherent in our legal systems, our Aboriginal legal systems, and they have names for them. There are names for each grade. There are names for heads of clans. There are names for the tribal councils. So, you know, it's long been unrecognised. It's still mostly unrecognised. It's only partially recognised. And even then, you know, having your native title recognised is extraordinarily difficult and painful and traumatic. So this is the way traditional people see it. You know, true recognition recognises these matters.
It's a reciprocity there.
The reciprocity parity, right? Mm. Parity.
But, you know, there's a later paragraph that comes in later, which is also interesting because, of course, you know, look, I've had, you know, this is years ago now, but I've had blind assessors' reports where I've used terms like alliance or constitution, particularly in relation to translating Yolngu terms from this language. And, you know, people have said, oh, well, you can't say that people, you know, had any sense of anything like these legal terms. I mean, this just doesn't
I've had it said to me too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they say it all the time. Mm. But, you know, it's interesting because this statement from 98 actually sets out a whole bunch of things that sound suspiciously like the tenets of law that we expect in a, liberal democratic society. There must be dialogue between the two systems of law because Yolngu law, like your law, is based on the key principles of mawaya, peace and justice, dapere, consistency between different levels of law, And when I looked on the ascent of traditional law holders / citizens to those laws, you know.
Ascent is an agreement.
Yeah, agreement. Yeah. That Dunny chamber is the chamber of ascent. It's almost like the upper house for us. It's like, you know, there's a chamber in which laws are formulated, which is Naha, which is the restricted one. Mm. And then the chamber of, you know, sort of revision / ascent, where everybody gets to hear what was decided and agree to whether they're going to agree to that or not, is the Dunny chamber. That's effectively how it works. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, I think the people, and it is primarily, you know, Babaji who is driving this document.
Mm. Sorry.
As all of these statements have been, sort of semantic, I think, you know, flexibility to even be able to make these leaps and think, well, what is the right term for this English term here that is taken for granted in common law, and what's the normal equivalent of that? I mean, that in itself is a fairly sophisticated philosophical exercise in its own right. We had to do one for a particular structural feature of the Dooney ground called the Rearwater. And it's the closest we could get in translating it. It's almost like the dock of a court. Mm. You know, it's where you give testimony. And that testimony is examined and cross-examined. Mm. And I'm not sure we actually came up with the right translation. Because most of these words don't have right or wrong translations, you know. They don't have direct mappings onto English. English is actually, as I keep reminding everybody, a really, really awful and blunt language in which to be discussing any of this. If we were doing this properly, we wouldn't even be having this conversation in English.
And it has to be said, like that word Marine, right? Many, many years ago, the elders were going to make that the theme of one of the Garma festivals. And I'm on the, you know, teleconference with them, and I'm stupid me says, what does Marine mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
And they said, okay.
Here we go. How long
well,
have you got?
Yeah. No. They treated me like, you know, poor thing.
Yeah.
It means beauty.
It does mean beauty.
Yeah, so these words can have, you know, lots of polysemy, lots of meanings, and beauty is a perfectly good translation, but, it's the translation that you give to dummies like me, right?
The other,
but it is legitimate, and it does mean that.
Mm.
But, they're not going to go into the finer details.
So people desert-centric societies, you know, have something like, you know, Al-Kiringa or Kurpa, which is possibly translatable as dreaming. It doesn't really mean dreaming. It's more like hypercognition.
Yeah.
What does the witch tail...
Super aware.
What does the witch tail eagle see? That's the true translation of dreaming from those desert languages. Yolngu people don't have dreaming, even though we mistranslate it all the time, and in fact they've just given up, so they mistranslate it thinking that we know what it means. They think we know what it means, so therefore they just, you know, default to that. So beauty, like the idea that nature is so awe-inspiringly beautiful in its forms is the sacred tenet of all, right? Mm. So nature and the way that we are and everything else is, from places to species to breeding cycles to whatever it might be, is innately perfect. It's a form of perfection. It's a form of sacred perfection in its own right. The other possible translation, of course, is nature. Back to sort of like everything having a way. Everything has a nature. Yeah, possums have a nature. Weather patterns have a nature. Tides have a nature. The moon has a nature. It's almost like, if, for anybody who knows about Zen Buddhism, it's almost like the concept of kami. You know, that everything has a kami. You know, so when somebody goes in Japan to try and, destroy a river or something, people will go and protest about it because they're protecting its ancestral essence. It's coming. Yeah.
So, I mean, what your book does, it's so important, is surface this for those who don't know or haven't seen. And it seems that an Australia that doesn't recognise the richness of Indigenous law and the importance of a reciprocity, of importance of a coming together, which is what the voice is really asking, that, as you said, Marcia, parity, like an ability, leader to leader, society to society, a balancing that we lose out.
I think we've also forgotten in, you know, response to that question, we've forgotten that Indigenous approaches and values to parity, equity, balance, respect have actually been part of formulating the voice question for at least 9 years. You know, and Noel Pearson, of course, was a big part of that. People are not going to a plebiscite on the 14th of October voting for a proposal that has been shaped by any one political party. In fact, the only way that we actually got to even having a referendum question is that there was a deep acceptance and desire to engage with constitutional conservatives, which has actually improved and refined the question in ways that nobody ever expected it would. And so the proposition being put to us, despite the way that social media and the 24-hour news cycle loves to spend these things, is not representative of any one dominant political ideology. It is a purely centrist proposition, and we need to engage with it in that spirit. And I don't mean centrist politically either. This is something that's been refined through constant dialogue and engagement for almost a decade to get the right referendum question that dignifies the importance and, I would dare say, sanctity of what we are being asked to do.
And what would it mean for the referendum to succeed? What society do we have after that?
Well, you know, I've said before, just to cut a long story short and make it easy to understand, that if we succeed in having the referendum question accepted by a majority of Australians and achieve the double majority, and the recognition of Indigenous Australians as the First Peoples is enshrined in the Constitution as the voice to Parliament and executive government, there is no longer us and them. Indigenous Australians are the First Peoples recognised in the Constitution, are therefore fully Australian and not excluded from the Constitution in the way that the Constitution presently excludes us. Long constitutional story there, but a few people in the room well understand how that happened. Probably a bit boring for the average punter. But we remain, because of the history of the Constitution and because of common law, pretty much excluded from the Constitution. It's, you know, not well taught. It's not taught in law schools. It's not taught in our schools. It's not taught to our history students. But that's the fact of the matter. If we succeed, there will be no us and them. Indigenous Australians will be part of the constitutional fabric of the country, and there will be parity in Parliament and the government because our voice will sit there to give advice, as elders do. They give advice. Nobody said the Parliament had to do what the voice says. That's not how it works. The Parliament will legislate the composition, powers and structure of the voice, and it will always have that parliamentary power, that parliamentary sovereignty, to rewrite the legislation and change it over time. But the voice will be there as an advisory body to guide the Parliament on the best way forward.
People have said this time and again. Noel Pearson said it. elders who aren't public figures have said it over and over. It's actually about building better partnerships and lines of sight so that there are better economies of policy delivery and spending. It's not about spending, of course, it's actually far more important than something as trivial as money, but it is about partnerships and building trust and lines of sight so that people do not have to solve insurmountable problems alone. You know, before we, you know, started talking regularly about this debate as it's worn on over the past months, I found myself doing an interview like this with our Yolngu professor, Brian Gumbler, and his wife, Renelle Gondara, who are both very, very senior ceremonial leaders from Northeast Arnhem Land. And the way they put it, which sort of surprised me at the time, was they said, we want feedback. And I sort of had to think about that. But it's like, people don't want to have to solve every single solution in an oppositional adversarial vacuum. You know, people actually want to build relationships of, you know, trust. So as Marcia says, you know, that we actually operate as a single people with a shared commitment to making this place lucky for everybody who's born here.
And I think indeed there's a certain urgency to the desire of the kinds of people we're talking about. They know that they face an existential threat, and it gets worse every year. The young are not following the law. There's, you know, rap music, there's drugs, there's alcohol. Children are taken away to go to school. Children are just taken away and put in juvenile justice centres or put into out-of-home care. People feel that their societies are under existential threat, and they want a, you know, a law-like way of drawing a line in the sand and getting a relationship with a society that places them in this great existential threat, so that they have a chance of their laws and cultures surviving into the future. And that's very much part of the logic of what is being proposed, very much the motivation.
Absolutely. And it seems to me that it's both ways. You talk about law as a gift. So law as a gift to the broader society, that with this reciprocity, there is a sense, you know, of everyone being able to have good lives. And
well, one in four Australians live in regional or remote Australia. They are the parts of Australia with the highest percentile proportions of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander populations as well. It stands to reason that when you go improving services, infrastructure and facilities in those parts of Australia, then if you're going to do it, then you're going to be doing it for everybody. And of course, a lot of those communities are heavily intermarried as well. There are often households that have both, you know, Indigenous and non-Indigenous people in them. Because guess what? People fall in love. And that's not a crime anymore, which is a great thing. That's progress. We need more of that progress. You know, we need to actually think seriously about the bigger crises that face Australia in a time of great global uncertainty, you know, and the high rates of things like, you know, homelessness and housing and affordability and lack of housing stock and all of that, and
climate change.
And we're not just looking to solve problems for a tiny subset of people, because those people are living where everybody else lives as well. And any growth in infrastructure is actually going to make critical inroads into addressing and mitigating some of those bigger problems. Mm-hmm. And I don't think most people have thought through that either. Mm-hmm. You know, postcode in Australia is a primary indicator of advantage and disadvantage.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we should be thinking about that in this equation as well.
Absolutely. And it seems very much it's about local and democratic decision making.
Very much. But also nationally, a settlement of the grievances, right? So there'll be a constitutional hook, if you like, that in and of itself is the peace settlement, right? And if we don't succeed, and on October 15 we discover that the majority of Australians have voted against it, it really will be a great tragedy. Because the generosity of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people in putting the solution on the table, the solution that they think will work best, being rejected by Australian voters would set the whole process back probably forever. You know, we were promised a second republic referendum by John Howard. It didn't occur. Most of us will never see it. And I think that's the case with this too.
Look, I think that the people who are Indigenous and support their communities, and people who aren't Indigenous and support, you know, the Indigenous people who they care about and love, are never going to walk away. You know, the idea that, you know, somehow that this is over completely is not realistic. I mean, people who are committed to these causes will never walk away from them. But politically...
But Australians will never get this opportunity again.
Yeah, but...
That's
but,
my point.
Yeah, but the existential threat is that politically, even if there is no, you know, I mean, a referendum is not a mandate for what happens in the next referendum or even the next election, but the perception that it is the threat, I think. And people are already spinning it that way and interpreting it that way, even though that in itself is a technical falsehood.
Can I ask you, just as we conclude, what can we learn then from the ancestors about living better as a society today and tomorrow?
There's a really short answer to that.
Yes, well, go on, go on.
I'm not sure it's fair for public consumption.
Well...
So the polite version of it is be a good person. That's the polite version of it. Be a good person, and you know, be self-critical, not to the point of paralysation, but be self-critical in a healthy way as to, you know, whether you can be a better person. That's all it is. I mean, that's what the ancestors teach. I'm pretty sure ancestors all over the world teach that. I don't think this is unique to Australia. It seems to be a fundament of all human societies, as far as I can see, at one fundamental level or another. But it's as accessible as that. Be a good person. I think also respect and humility. Responsibilities over rights. You know, a matrix of responsibilities is much more a driving, you know, set of principles for what law is and how people interact with each other than an idea of, you know, innate rights. You know, you earn rights through responsibilities because you can demonstrate that you can exercise rights through responsibilities.
And it doesn't mean that you have to be, you know, a sook.
No.
It doesn't mean that at all.
No,
you know,
no.
Nobody would have ever survived if we were all, you know, mushy and sooky.
In fact, it's the complete opposite, isn't it? It's like pull yourself together you know, take some, you know, have some self-respect. It's more like that.
We have processes we follow. This
it's,
is
yeah, it's more like tough love.
Yeah, it's tough love.
It's tough love, yeah. It's like, you know, you have a responsibility to actually be a good person. And that's something that you have to do.
Yeah, and I think it's the perfect way to end for tonight. And Thank you both so much. I know it's a really exhausting time. It's a really difficult time, so I really appreciate Professor Langton, Professor Korn, conversation, all of you tonight as well, and to the Labor Academy, you know, for hosting this, and here's to many more important conversations and important decisions that we all get to participate in. Thanks so much.
Great.
It's a good book. Wonder who wrote it.